you know, the 3 month span where Thomas saw about 20 different doctors.
Oh my gosh.
We had an ER doctor for hours trying to figure out what was going on. I said, do you think it's narcolepsy? And they said, absolutely not. You know, they thought maybe he had depression at one point.
With Liza, I think it started in the winter and she was diagnosed in the summer. But, you know, at the beginning, you know, I pick her up from camp. She'd go to sleep in the car, and she'd sleep for 12 hours in a row, you know? And she could get up the next day and sleep another 6 hours. So by the time that you couldn't deny that it was a growth spurt, obviously it wasn't a growth spurt, so we went in and she did.
It just didn't seem normal to be sleeping all the time and to only want to sleep. So they would ask me, like, what my sleep schedule was like, and I would just say, I'm sleeping all the time.
Hi there. Dr. Maski.
Hi, nice to meet you.
Hi there.
Me too.
Is it Liza?
Yeah, I'm Liza.
So I just finished my visit with 15-year-old Liza. It's not uncommon to hear about teenagers with insufficient sleep, and certainly sleepiness is a very common symptom that we're hearing from adolescents. The misdiagnosis or partial treatment of some aspect of narcolepsy make it more difficult to diagnose.
Have you ever fallen asleep while you're actively doing something?
Yeah, some ballet classes, I'll like be doing my pliés and I'll just be like, oh, just so tired. My eyes will like droop over.
Most strikingly, it wasn't just sleepiness in boring classes or in car rides, relatively mundane things. She was actually falling asleep during her activities.
Sometimes I think I'm walking down like a road. And sometimes I'll think like I see like different lights in places, which is like weird.
Typically visual hallucinations that occur during the time of sleep onset or offset can be very vivid to the point where patients often report not really knowing if it's something real or not real.
Ever have something called sleep paralysis? This is a symptom where you wake up, your brain is awake, but your body seems to be still asleep.
I don't think I've ever really had that. Doctors definitely curious to see what your sleeping pattern is like. If you're really not getting good sleep at night and you are like falling asleep in all of your classes at school, and if it's affecting your life to the degree that you really can't function.
After I took a full history of her symptoms, tried to understand if there was any onset of head trauma or illness or immunization that may have brought on her symptoms, basically to see if there was any headaches, visual disturbances, or changes in personality.
She's a very bubbly girl, but any concerns of mood changes or increased weight gain or weight loss with Liza?
No, no changes in her weight, but I do see tearfulness at times.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Yeah, I can understand that.
Yeah, because it can be sad. I'm just like, asleep.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And she missed a lot of things.
It's also been hard missing out on like family activities and like hanging out with my sisters. And it's definitely put a separation between me and my sisters a little bit. Yeah.
Liza is a very unique individual. She's really upbeat, high energy, and her symptoms of sleepiness are out of character with her personality and her level of outgoingness. So it's a really striking difference in her case. She did start to have symptoms of cataplexy, an intrusion of REM sleep in wakeful periods, triggered by strong emotion, such as laughter, annoyance, anger, being emotionally upset.
It would happen almost every time I laughed. I would just fall over. It was pretty scary, honestly, because I was just lost complete control. I could hear everything that's going on around me, but I couldn't talk or communicate with people if they were confused.
One of the conditions I'm have to evaluate for is called narcolepsy. It's a lifelong chronic disease. The hallmark symptom is excess daytime sleepiness all the time.
Probably most critical is to do an overnight sleep study as well as a multiple sleep latency test, a test that's trying to quantify the amount of daytime sleepiness a person has. And that really is sort of the gold standard in terms of diagnosing someone with narcolepsy.
We'll be using an EEG. So these are sort of sticky leads on her head that are looking at her brainwave activity that tells us what sleep states she's in. In the morning, we'll be looking over a course of 5 nap periods from 9 a.m. to 6 p.m., how quickly you fall asleep.
What we're looking for is whether there's any REM periods during those naps. And if there's two REM periods within the five naps, that's consistent with the diagnosis of narcolepsy.
I was totally doubting that I'd be able to fall asleep, but then once I got in the bed, I was out like a light bulb.
She certainly seems to have all the components necessary to make the diagnosis of narcolepsy. The excessive daytime sleepiness, the hypnopompic hypnagogic hallucinations. She has very vivid dreams. She has very fragmented sleep, plus the presence of two REM periods during daytime naps. So we're confident in our diagnosis. She does have narcolepsy with cataplexy. If a patient feels that their symptoms are not explained sufficiently by lack of sleep or any other sort of underlying disorder, I think that it would be important for them to be seen by a sleep specialist.
Getting diagnosed made me so much more like relieved because I knew, okay, thank God there's something that's like literally wrong, like in my brain, that there's something off, because I thought there was something just wrong with me, like, but it's scientific. That was helpful.